Good morning. Welcome, everyone. If this is your first time, a special welcome to you. My name's Mike. I'm one of the worship leaders, and not often do we get to do services like this. Mark, who will be speaking, will be talking about who Jesus is. Not just Son of God, Messiah, but who is Jesus and his transformational power. I'd like to extend a welcome to Max here. He's on break from college. And as everyone knows, with this crazy COVID world, Jake was supposed to play guitar. He's playing drums. We had a couple other people who couldn't make it. And Max stepped up, and he's singing three of the songs. So thank you, Max. And I'd like to invite you all to stand. And please join us in a song that I'm sure you folks have heard us play many times. Great are you, Lord.
Earth will everyone. Happy New Year. Mike, if you needed help in the band, you could have just asked. I'm always available. But that sounded awesome. Thanks, guys. Well, you are a truly blessed crowd. You want to know why? I'm going to tell you. We only have one service today, 9 a.m. So if anyone shows up at 10:30, I'm not saying they're not blessed. I'm just saying they're going to be missing out on some good music and a great message. We will return to two services starting next week, January 9th. So 9 and 10:30. Just wanted you all to know you could sleep in next week if you want to. All right, so for quick announcements today, in addition to what I just told you, I am hosting, like I do the first Sunday of every month, our Get to Know NEC session. And I'm going to do that right here on the front of the sanctuary, right after this service. And this is an opportunity to learn just a little bit about our history, our vision, our mission, who we are, and ask any questions you have of me. So if you're interested in getting to know us a little bit better, please join me after service. And finally, like we do the second Sunday of every month, we start our new journey class. Now, I have talked about this journey class before, and I've said to you, if you're new to faith, if you want to dig a little deeper into God and into the Bible, this is an opportunity for you. But I want to add that even if you have been coming to church for a really long time, even if you feel like I kind of know that's not for me, this is an opportunity for you to join a small group. It's an opportunity to grow in your faith. In fact, we encourage all of our leaders and volunteers to participate in that. So it's something you've been thinking about. We would love for you to join us. You can find more information online and sign up. So Happy New Year, everyone.
This world I walk alone with no place to call my home, but there's one who holds my hand. Take my life and
And that, Heather, is why you don't get a phone call for that. Phew, she's not out yet. Hey, Happy New Year, guys. That was terrible. What a horrible way to start New Year's. That's why, Heather, you don't get phone calls? I am so sorry. I need to make amends with her. Jeez. Yeah, good morning. Welcome. If this, like we said, if this is your first time, awesome to have you here. If this is your fourth time, great. If you got tricked into coming on New Year's and then you're trying to resolve your life and you said, I'm going to come today as a New Year's resolution, welcome to you as well. But I'm also going to welcome those who have been here for like 15 years. You guys never get welcomed, ever. It's always the new people, which I'm grateful to have you here as well. But those that have been here for like 15 plus years, you also, just so you know, are welcome to be here. We're grateful that you're here. Thank you for being here. It's awesome to have you. Yeah, absolutely. So I'm just going to start. We're going to go right into this, that I think that New Year's resolutions are dumb. That's what I've like really, really boiled life down to. So now that I've welcomed you all and you've all spent the weekend coming up with a resolution and you're really like, I'm going to change now. I think it's dumb what you're doing, just so you know. It's my own stuff, guys. All of this is my own stuff. I don't even know why they give me a microphone up here. You all are my counselors, so thank you for being here. Here's what I find with New Year's resolutions. For me, is I just find they don't stick, right? I mean, there's all research and studies. You can read that stuff. But I just find that they don't stick. So for me, they become just like a waste of time. Because 1 month later, I'm depressed because I'm functioning the same way that I thought I was going to change. That's what it really comes down to. And so I get really frustrated. I realize that I don't have stick-to-itiveness, and I can't, you know, do the thing that I want to do and change 1 month later, and I'm doing the same stuff. And so I resolve myself to be more stick-to-itive, and then I'm still not as stick-to-itive. Like, it just becomes this vicious circle, and a year passes, and all of a sudden, you know, I'm in the same spot. And so resolutions become very challenging for me. But here's the irony of all this, is that I'm in an industry that actually thrives, and I want you all to have resolutions because I'm in the fitness world. I own a gym. So please resolve yourself. Come on in, starting Monday. Always start Monday. So it's ironic to me that this becomes something that I get so frustrated by. But here's what I find for myself. I'll speak for myself, not for you guys. Is that I think what I like is I like the idea of changing. Like, I really do. I like the idea of changing, right? I can go through the whole list of things. I'm not home enough. I spend more time on my phone than I do talking to my kids. I don't eat right. I don't exercise enough. All these things. I start going through, and I like the idea that, man, I wish I was different. I wish I could change. I want to probably even actually change, I think. But then that takes a process, and it takes time, none of which I want to do. I don't deal with process, and I don't deal with time, right? So I'm working with a kid right now he's a high school, 17-year-old kid, and he's a very good football player. And so he just wants to keep putting weights on the bar, right? Let's just keep loading up the bar. Put more weights on the bar. This is ridiculous. I'm so much stronger than you, than you're allowing me to be right now. He wants to come into the gym and all of a sudden just build strength yesterday, right? But what does that take? For all of us, we all know this. We don't go from, like, today I look and feel this way, and then all of a sudden tomorrow I gain 30 pounds. That doesn't happen. It's a process that gets us there, right? And so for him, he wants, just put on the weight, put on the weight. I just want to put on more weight. And so I say, what happens if we spent more time on moving well so that the weight will go up exponentially? But you know what that takes? Time. You know what he is? 17 years old. He doesn't have that. We live in this world and culture of like instant gratification, right? That's what makes resolutions, I find, for myself so difficult. Because I don't want to spend the time or go through the process. I want it to just happen tomorrow. But today I actually don't want to spend a ton of time talking about resolutions. Because I do, but what I do want to talk about is an idea Because even that, right, even let's just say that for me, I live in my phone, and I know that my kids are asking me a question, and I ignore it or don't hear it because I'm so focused on the thing that I have to do. So there's this idea, I need to change that. I want to change that behavior. I really do. And there's a process that I have to go through, and there's time for me to unbreak some poor habits that I have. So I have to have that idea, but then I've got to go through part two, and the hard part is that I actually need to change. But today, I don't want to necessarily talk just about that. I want us to talk about how we do this with God. Is that we oftentimes can have this idea of who we think God is as it relates to how he should impact our lives. And so we have this idea of who he is, and maybe that idea will help us change, and maybe it won't. So we do need to come to understand then who is Jesus, who is God, not just our idea of him, but who does he actually say he is? And then on the other side, is who he is actually changing us? And that's what I want to look at because that is a very, very challenging thing to do. Who he says he is, not just what my idea of is, who he says he is, and is who he is actually going to change me? Or how does it actually change me if I'm willing to give time and go through a process with him? And so there's this interaction with Jesus that we're going to take a look at today. He had it with his very close friends. You know, you might hear this a lot if you come to church, right? The disciples. They're these 12 guys who are really close to him. They follow him around all over the place. They see all the things. They're actually with him, right? And I think that we have a little bit of this, I don't know. I think we look at the disciples as like, of course. Of course they've got their lives together. They're walking around with Jesus. They're seeing all the miracles. He's teaching them stuff. But here's the thing about the disciples is they are just like us. Even though they're around him a lot, even though you would say, well, their lives are transformed all the time. Are they? Yes, they sure are. And there's time and a process, but there's 3 years that they spend with him, right, in his ministry with Jesus. And so we see things that they deny Jesus, even though they've spent all this time with him and should be transformed by him. Or we see that they sit there and argue with each other about who's better than the other person. It's like my kids. Or they fall asleep when Jesus says, hey, can you stay awake with me just for right now? I am going through hell. Can you just stay awake with me and pray with me and be with me? And they fall asleep. So we see that even though they are with him, Jesus, all the time, they still wrestle with transformation and change. But I want to look at this passage, and it happens to be in 3 of the 4 biographies of Jesus. And so I think that's always worth looking at if we read the story 3 times with 3 different viewpoints. So we're going to look at this. We're going to look at Matthew's account of this interaction, and it happened in Matthew 16. And starting in verse 13. And I want us to look through the lens as we go through this of chasing an idea of who Jesus is. And are they willing to trust the process of what he's going to do in their lives because of who he is? So here's how this story goes. Jesus arrived in the villages, verse 13. When Jesus arrived in the villages of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, his really close friends, what are the people saying about who the Son of Man is? What is the idea that these people have of who I am? And so they replied, well, some think he is John the Baptizer. Some say Elijah, some Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. And, you know, I think that this is pretty telling because what we see in their responses, right? John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, prophets. So these are like ministry moguls they whip out. Like really, people that they would know. That's who people think you are. But I think it's telling because I think when we start seeing them list a whole bunch of other people, I think what we see is their idea, they have this idea of who he should be mirroring, right? Who should Jesus look like? Well, probably one of these guys. And so they can run after that idea. So John the Baptist, the voice crying out in the wilderness, right? That is how the Bible will talk about him. So he's a guy with a different point of view. So maybe when they're saying, hey, this is like John the Baptist, maybe they're saying, well, I think Jesus, the idea of what I have with what Jesus is he is, I don't know, some guy with a different point of view. Was he? Yeah, he sure was. He did have a different point of view. But was that who he is? Or maybe he's like a prophet. Maybe he's someone who's going to come and then tell us, hey, there's hope. There's something good that's coming ahead of you. Does Jesus do that? He absolutely does. That's what he does. But is that who he is? And I think what happens with what the people are saying and what we say too is that idea, we take something, we take a person or an image or an idea of what we think Jesus is, and it shrinks him and makes him so small. Because yes, those are parts of who he is. But is that entirely who he is, and will that transform us or change us? But it's not until they can actually understand who he is that they can be changed. That he's very different than just a mirror of someone else. So then, who is Jesus? So Jesus pressed them, the disciples, how about you? Who do you say that I am? And when I see that, when I read that question and I imagine myself in that room, all that I think about is me in like physics class when my teacher's like, hey, what's the answer to this particular question? And my eyes are just like, don't pick on me. Please don't call on me. Please don't call on me. I have no idea. You know, Jesus says, who do you think I am? Ah, don't ask me, please, please. Ask John, he'll know. But let's stop and ask ourselves the question. Who do you say Jesus is? And I mean really, like, who do you say he is? Is it this idea, or is it who he actually is? We're going to get to that. We'll get to who he is. You know, is he just some guy who, when the time is right and he can defend your opinion, you can pull a quote from the Bible and just throw it at somebody? Is that who he is for you? Is he just this good teacher who kind of makes good points? Is he somebody who kind of gets you off the hook when you need him to get you off the hook? Is he supposed to make our lives easier? Is he, I don't know. Is he somebody who I can just use as sort of a vending machine and be like, ah, I'm in a tough spot right now. You need to get me out of this tough spot. Who do you say that Jesus is? Who do I say that he is? Well, finally, somebody answers the question in that room, and it's Peter. So Simon Peter said, you're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. You're the one we've hoped for. You're the one that's going to rescue us from just chasing our tails. You're the one that's going to heal us. You're the one that's going to be the person, the Son of Man, the Christ, God himself in flesh. You're going to be, you are the one that is going to heal, rescue, save me. And Jesus came back and he said this, God bless you, Simon, son of Jonah. You didn't get that answer out of books or from teachers. What a fascinating way Jesus responds here, right? You didn't get an answer just from reading this. You didn't get just like some idea in your head or just said, hey, I like this John the Baptist guy. I think Jesus is kind of like him. You didn't just get that idea from that. What does he say? Where did you get this from? My Father in heaven, God himself, let you on the secret of who I really am. So he gets something put into him by God himself. This is who I am. I came to rescue, heal, and save you. The Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. But then what happens after that? So that's the idea, right? That's who he is. That's what God himself has put on Peter's heart, which is awesome, but still, that's just a concept. But then change happened, right? Then change happens because Jesus goes on and he says, and now I'm going to tell you who you really are. You are Peter, a rock. And this is the rock on which I will put together my church, a church so expansive with energy and not even the gates of hell will be able to keep it out. And that's not all. You will have complete and free access to God's kingdom. Keys to open any and every door. No more barriers between heaven and earth, earth and heaven. And yes on earth is a yes in heaven, and a no on earth is a no in heaven. So Peter sees it. He gets the idea. He's the Messiah. He came to save, rescue, heal me. Save me from myself. Give me this unmerited grace, forgiveness, love, mercy, all of it. He sees and knows that there is nothing that I can do to make God love me more or less. And I think we need to let that settle in, that there is nothing we can do. We can't earn God's love, his favor. And I think that's an idea of what we have with God so often. I've got to do the right things. I've got to pay attention. I've got to do whatever your checklist is. That is what initiates the relationship. But God himself actually initiates the relationship first. He has given us unconditional love that we can't earn it from him. We're not chasing the idea because he has already come and loves us first. And when we can live in that deep love, that deep understanding of who God is, that idea of love that he has given us first, then change and transformation can happen because then we can turn around and give that to the people around us. We're not giving it to the people around us so that God loves us. We give it because he loved us first. And I'll tell you what, guys, I can't tell you how often I forget this. I'm like Peter. I mean, Peter, soon after he said, here's who you are. You're the Messiah. You came to rescue, heal me. You love me unconditionally. He said that, right? He had the idea. He knew it. Jesus then says, you're a transformed man. The church is going to be built on you. What happens soon after? He's the guy who's like, I don't know this guy. Right? I mean, how? That seems so backwards. I thought he changed. Here's the thing, is we live in and out of understanding and letting God's love transform us and change us. I mean, talk to my family. How many times do I fly off the handle, Brady? Enough times? Never mind, don't answer that. I am love also. Or that my phone is more important than my conversation with my kids. Or that I don't have enough time for a date with my wife. Or whatever thoughts that I actually have in my head, which I don't want anyone to know. How often do I sink back into those things? And I get wrapped up in my own selfishness. And then what happens? The next year comes and I'm in the same spot. But Peter goes, what a tremendous example of someone who I think we can actually relate to. Because he goes in and out of recklessness. But he still is going through time and process of being changed and transformed by God. Because he becomes the rock that the church will be built on. Even though he functions in a very dysfunctional way. And he forgets it, but God still extends his love. And he denies Jesus, and he still extends his love. Read later, and he asks him 3 times, do you love me? And Peter's like, absolutely. You know, later on in the Bible, Peter actually wrote a couple books. And so here's what he said that I hope encourages us, because it takes that from the idea, change, and then what does change look like, And this is what Peter says it looks like. Because it continues just to reiterate that we don't have to earn anything. We just have to be in God's love and then let that shine to others. So this is what he says. He says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. That you may, and this part can be tough because it's not so that you belong to God and you're a royal priesthood. You're all these awesome things. Understand that. And that's important, that God has given us that. And he doesn't say, so now, go be a better parent. Or, and now, stop drinking so much. Or, and now, fill in whatever the thing is for you. What does he say? That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. Right? What a freeing, powerful image. It's not so, I've given you all this love, you're now a chosen people, so let's function a certain way. It's so that you can declare who I am, thank me and praise me so that you get called out of darkness into the light. And Peter, I think, can only write that because he understands of life where he was in darkness and was brought into Christ's wonderful light. And guys, when we are willing to say, who are you? You are the Christ. You are the one who has come to save and rescue and heal me. You've extended your love to me. If we can wrap our heads around that idea, open ourselves up to that idea, we get called into his wonderful light. So who do you say that Jesus is? Who do I say that Jesus is? He's inviting us all into his goodness, into his wonderful light. So here's a sort of a prayer for this week. And I know we're all in so many different spots, but I also don't care if you've been coming here for 15 years or one day, because this is something we all need to be reminded of and go back to or go to it. God, help me to chase after you, right? God, help me to chase after you. Not all the things. God, help me to chase after you, to chase after your love that you've so freely given me. And bring me into your wonderful light. Pray that this week, every day if you can. Help me to chase after your love and bring me into your wonderful light. And then my prayer is that that light that he invites us into, we can just radiate to those around us. And maybe even come to the gym. Let's say a prayer. God, easy to talk about. Ideas are easy to think about. But it's hard sometimes to go through time and process. Because that's a scary prayer. God, I want to chase after your love. Because sometimes we don't feel like we are loved, and sometimes we don't feel like we do the right things, and sometimes we think that we have to earn who you are. So my prayer is that we can, no matter how we feel, let this be absorbed into our hearts. That like Peter, we can hear God's voice, who is telling us this over and over and over again. May we live in your light. I pray these things in your son's name. Amen.
Could you please stand and join us in our final song? This is a new one. It's one of my all-time favorites. Max will lead us again, but in case you listen to K-Love, you'll know this song, and please join us.
You are here, working. working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. Worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. Worship you. I worship you.
You're working, even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Have a great day. We love you. God bless.